Joining me now to discuss the economic challenges from the White House, President Trump's top economic advisor, Larry Kudlow. Mr. Kudlow, it's good to see you. Thank you so much for joining us. I want to start with what the government is doing to help Americans through the crisis. Do you think there's going to be a phase four stimulus bill? And if so, should it include money for state and local governments?
Well, I don't want to get too far ahead of the story, Jake. There may well be additional legislation. There's kind of a pause period right now. You know, we put up $3 trillion of direct federal budget assistance in one way or another. The Federal Reserve has actually put in as much as $4-6 trillion. So it's a huge, huge package. Let's see how it's doing as we gradually reopen the economy. We probably will have some ideas. And I want to say this, that regarding the states, as you know, the president has from time to time spoken about linking that to sanctuary cities. I don't think anything's been decided yet regarding health care and all manner of medical equipment. We have poured hundreds of billions into the states. Perhaps there'll be more of that. We'll wait and see. From our perspective, too, Jake, look, we know the economy is still in a terrible contractionary phase, tremendous hardships everywhere. That's why we've put up several rescue packages led by President Trump and with the bipartisan support of the Congress. So we are working through that. It's going to be very difficult in the months ahead, no question. Having said that, I will note that the Congressional Budget Office and a bunch of private forecasters, Wall Street Journal surveys and so forth, are looking for a very strong second half economic rebound and suggesting that 2021 next year could be one of the fastest growth rebounds in American history or recent history. So we're trying to get from, you know, from one side to the other. We're trying to get through this. We're trying to work through this. I don't want to rule in or out anything right now. We are in discussions internally and with leading members of Congress.
Right. But you talk about a pause, a moment of pause that we're in right now. The Fed chair, Jerome Powell, indicated this week that he believes Congress needs to pass additional measures providing direct fiscal support to Americans. I don't understand the reason for a pause. Why not take action aggressively now, considering how dire a situation so many Americans are in?
Well, look, first of all, we have to execute the last package. And the numbers are very strong. These are the small business loans. As of, I guess, Friday, we put up over $100 billion already just in a few days. That's, of course, on top of the prior $350 billion. Look, Jake, 175 million Americans, 175 million Americans have received federal assistance in one form or another. That includes the direct checks, of course, and the unemployment compensation and the small business assistance. So I guess what I would say to you at this particular juncture, let's execute the continuation of what we've already done. Let's see what the results are. The outlook in the weeks and months ahead directly is not positive, as you've noted. The unemployment is very, very high, almost 30 million people. We are covering them with generous relief packages, just trying to stabilize things and get folks through this. And then right. We will see in a couple of weeks, Jake, what needs to be done and perhaps how to do it.
So the second tranche of money for the Small Business Administration's Paycheck Protection Program, the SBA just a few minutes ago released new numbers suggesting that of that $310 billion, $175 billion has already been approved. In just one week, $175 billion approved. Doesn't that suggest that there is a real need and waiting further doesn't really make any sense? I mean, plaudits to the administration and the Congress for getting this money to the SBA, getting it out the door. The average loan is smaller, suggesting that it's going to smaller businesses, and that's all great. But doesn't that also suggest there's a real need? You need more money in that program.
It may be, Jake. It may be. We haven't made a decision yet. I agree with your points. This has been an extremely popular and effective program, no question about it. You know, keeping folks on the payroll is so important. And even if they're furloughed for a while, They'll be picked up by the unemployment compensation. So, yes, that suggests, I might add, a potential strong spring back once the states gradually phase in their reopenings in the transition months of May and June. So I don't want to rule it out. I think your point is well taken. You know, we waited a little bit too long, I thought, when the last tranche ran out. Let's not make the same mistake again. We will be looking at that. But we also want to look at some medium-term items. President is very keen on a payroll tax holiday for the workers. We've got one for business. He'd like one on the workers. We'd like to see some significant deductions for, you know, tax deductions for business entertainment, going to sports, athletic events. We're trying so hard to help everybody open up. Mm-hmm. We're looking at people being able to write off if you have new expenses in any area, whether you're inventing vaccines or whether you're redoing your factories or office buildings to help on the COVID-19 medical side, best practices. We'd like to see that completely expensed. We'd also like to mm-hmm. see some shield on liabilities, because we don't want small business to stay closed because they think they're going to be sued right away. So these are all mixes. I call them economic growth incentives. So we have lots of cash and liquidity. Now it's time to look forward to economic growth incentives. We did it once, Jake. We had a very strong economy during the Trump years, and right. even during the first few months of this year. We'd like to apply the same free enterprise principles. Besides the second half mm-hmm. rebound, I think 2021 could be a spectacular year in the economy with the right set of policies.
Right. Well, from your mouth to God's ears. The Washington Post is reporting that the White House, led by economic advisor Kevin Hassett, built a different coronavirus model, which aides interpreted to show that deaths would have already peaked and that there would be far fewer fatalities than initially foreseen. The Washington Post is reporting that this presentation affirmed skepticism within the West Wing about what people like Dr. Fauci and Dr. Redfield and Dr. Birx were saying, health experts were saying, about the severity of the crisis. Is that true? Was there a separate economic model led by Kevin Hassett that predicted that was a counterbalance that fed skepticism in the West Wing?
You know, as Kevin Hassett himself said in that story, that is not true, Jake. Absolutely not true. I've known Kevin many years. He is a brilliant guy, and he's a person of great integrity. Look, what he was doing was taking that Bill Gates, the Gates model, it's not Bill Gates, but the Gates model from the University of Washington, and basically smoothing it out to show what is actually happening. There's a difference between a forecast trend and what has actually happened. He was clarifying the situation. He was not changing the situation. We have, from day one, abided by the advice and guidance of our top medical people, Dr. Fauci, Ambassador Birx, and many others in HHS and FDA. This idea that somehow we were creating a new model is simply not the case. Sometimes you can clarify it, maybe a little complex for our purposes this morning, but it was basically a smoothing technique for real world actual. It was less of a forecast. So we didn't change anything based on that. And Mr. Hassett is a person of great integrity, and I will defend that. I will absolutely defend that. His quotes in that story couldn't have been clearer.
I guess the reason for the disconnect is that sometimes the people who understandably want to get the economy up and running have been saying things that contradict what some of the people who are health experts in the administration are saying. For instance, at the end of February, Dr. Nancy Messonnier, who apparently got in the doghouse for saying in a conference call, doghouse with President Trump, for saying in a conference call that it was not a matter of if, but when there would be a severe disruption to the American people and our way to live life. And that's the same day, as you know, that you said this. Let's roll that tape.
We have contained this, I won't say airtight, but pretty close to airtight. We've done a good job in the United States.
So I guess the question is there a disconnect between what people such as you who want things to be better than they are so as to help the economy are saying and what people in the health field are saying?
Well, look, Jake, for the umpteenth time, I will say my quote then was based on the actual facts, which at the time there were only 40 or 50 cases. And it was contained, particularly after President Trump boldly put up travel restrictions with China. That's what the I didn't make a forecast so far. And that was just there was hardly any cases. OK, now, yes, some doctors were more fearful. Other doctors had many different things to say. I don't want to get in and play this game. Who said what and when? Political leaders, one well-known political leader in the House went to Chinatown in San Francisco and said everything is okay. Okay. One important anchor on your network as late as mid-March said basically the COVID-19 virus was no worse than an ordinary flu year. I mean, there are people saying, my quote was at that time, there were very few cases.